Good now. I hope you're doing well. Whoever and wherever you are across the world, thank you very much for tuning in and joining me. It's great to have you. As always, if you happen to be a returning viewer or subscriber, or welcome if you happen to be new here. This is a weekly series that I publish every Tuesday at 3 p.m. Eastern Standard or Eastern Daylight Time. That's pretty much the standard publishing time for all of my videos. But as you may or may not know, this particular talking series that is somewhat rambly, somewhat topical. Once a month, I share my little personal stories and anecdotes. And like I said, every Tuesday it gets published. But obviously, you are free to tune in and listen, watch whenever it suits you. So the big topic for this episode is, I guess, we could say the anxiety, stress, and worries that often surround or are attached with or involved with. It's probably a better word to use. When it comes to change and the future, the unknown, uncertainty, the anxiety of certain change, the anxiety and worry of uncertain and unknown change, especially in this modern society, technologically advanced modern society that we live in. And whether you are in school now, maybe you're just starting your first year of high school, maybe you're in a grade younger than that, maybe you are graduating this year, maybe you have been out of school for a long time, a decade, couple decades, and you have a career where you're going from job to job. But the point is, no matter what situation we find ourselves in, there is always going to be, to some degree, anxiety, stress, and worries about not just life in general, but our careers, the future, jobs, how are we going to make money, being able to afford things, bills and rent, mortgage, car payments, etc. So the landscape is somewhat always changing, mostly because of technology. So I want to touch on a little bit about AI, artificial intelligence, and what the landscape for jobs and careers is going to look like 50, 100 years from now, maybe in just another year or two. But this isn't just strictly about artificial intelligence, because it may or may not affect everyone. It depends on how advanced artificial intelligence technology, artificial intelligence, how advanced it becomes. Right now, artists and writers are probably feeling a little bit, nervous and apprehensive and threatened by the capabilities of artificial intelligence and where it's at right now. But who's to say it won't impact other types of careers? For example, manufacturing. There are a lot of machines that have put a lot of people out of work when it comes to car manufacturing, or even when it comes to candy and food and snack manufacturing. We have the factories and all their machines and the conveyor belts, and so there are a lot of machines at work right now that do things that people once did. So that's nothing new too much in that regard. But what is AI going to do beyond art and writing and text? Now, is it possible that AI will take over managerial positions? There'll probably, we don't have robots just yet that can replace human beings. But, there are people working, over the last few years or decade or so. I'm not sure if you've seen, random videos here and there about robots trying to move packages, or, robots in the supermarket telling you where certain items might be. Kind of basic designs, but who knows, 50 years from now, 100 years from now, will AI and robots converge and begin to replace humans? It might sound like a stretch, but maybe it's not. I don't want to over exaggerate, and I want to talk about these things, and I'm going to go off on some tangents here, because I don't want to focus just on AI and art and where AI is right now. I kind of want to look at the overall picture, kind of step back and have a world view. Try to have an objective view as possible. And look at all facets of life in society and things like that. So it's bad enough that we worry about what we're going to do with our lives. Maybe you don't have a career. Maybe you're not sure what you want to do with your life. So there's worry there. The future is uncertain. And blah, blah, blah. And maybe you do have a career, all right? And so, but even with that career, no job is guaranteed for life anymore. So you just, most of us, we just go about our day kind of assuming that everything's going to be okay, and there'll always be a job, and I'll get a job, and, things like that. So there's already some built-in worry and anxiety when it comes to just everyday life, having a job, going to school. But I want to talk about the added worry, or the additional anxiety when it comes to the unknown, the uncertainty of tomorrow might bring and might cause, and the added stress and anxiety of AI and just of the future in general. So I'm going to touch on a lot of different things. I guess we have to go back to the beginning, to our ancestors, right? So 10,000, 30,000 years ago, there we were, more primitive, living primitive lifestyles. And there was no technology. There was no society, quote unquote. There was hunter-gatherer society and different forms of little small societies scattered all across the world. But I'm talking about hunter-gatherers before we formed little civilizations. So before the Mayan civilization and any of that, talking about the people that just nomadic hunter and gatherers that had to move constantly based upon the food that was available. So they didn't farm. There was no agriculture. It was just kind of very precarious, I guess, life. And just imagine the worry and the anxiety of that lifestyle. There was no modern medicine. It was very brutal, primitive kind of life. There was more, they say, some researchers, anthropologists, or whoever, say there was more leisure time that our ancestors, hunter-gatherer ancestors, had more leisure time than what we do today. Regardless of that, I'm sure there was a lot of worry and anxiety with being a hunter-gatherer. I mean, you had predators, right? You had to worry about that, sleeping. I don't know how these slept and through the night safely. You had snakes to worry about and mountain lions and bears and who knows what else, right? So that's just the anxiety and stress of day-to-day of a hunter-gatherer primitive human being. There was no such concepts of jobs or anything like that. And then at some point, started to learn to farm. And so farming and agriculture, those were the beginning of the worries and anxiety when it comes to having your job replaced. Because you have someone that farms now and has all these pigs or corn that people can go to get in large quantities. And then you have the small person. This little analogy is kind of like comparing a small business owner to a big, giant chain store. Now you have the small pharmacist. Long time ago, this small little convenience store, and then what happened? And then Walmart came along, Best Buy, and now we have Amazon, right? So those big companies put the small companies, small little independent shop owners, out of business. I mean, everywhere you go today, for the most part, depends on where you live, but it's a big chain store. It's a, here in the United States, we have chain pharmacy / convenience stores called CVS and Rite Aid. They're everywhere. So, I mean, good luck trying to start your own pharmaceutical, you know, little drugstore. Not anymore. Now there's a CVS. Who's going to go to your drugstore when I can go to CVS? And they have everything more advanced and blah, blah, blah. So go back, like I was just talking about, to our primitive ancestors and when farming started to occur. So now you have someone trying to make a living selling whatever food they caught while hunting. Well, now you have this person farming and breeding cattle or pigs, chickens, what have you. And so that little independent hunter-gatherer, you know, well, they're not going to make a living anymore selling what food they caught while hunting. So they're going to probably need to compete and start a farm themselves. I mean, that's just kind of summing it up and putting it very simply. You know, it was a gradual process going from primitive to farming to society, etc. And then the Industrial Revolution happened, technology, computers, and so here we are. So the stress and the worry and anxiety about having a job, that's pretty much always have been there. Just the stress and anxiety of a job or the future, the unknown, uncertainty. Now, that's always been there. But it could be becoming more prevalent now. There's more people. There are 8 billion and counting people on the planet. But, you know, you have a lot of people in dense urban city areas, and then they move out into the suburbs, and those areas slowly become more dense to a degree, you know, based on how much they can build up and how many more houses or apartments they can make, based on the land available. But so, you know, the more people you have in one area, the less jobs in that area. So a lot of people have to commute and travel, you know, half an hour, an hour from where they live to the job they have to go to. So there's a lot of anxiety and worry for people in the densely populated areas because of job scarcity. Too many people, not enough jobs in those dense areas. So I don't want to focus too much on jobs. But that is a big thing, you know, a huge, important part of the conversation and piece to the puzzle, because in modern society, you need money to survive. So you need a job to make money. So the worry and anxiety, you know, it's always been there. I mean, at a very basic level, you know, in terms of survival, you're always worried about a predator, you know. So there's always keeping your senses, keeping your wits about you, watching out for, you know, anything that might harm you. So there's that, you know. And then you have, you know, worrying about all kinds of different stuff, you know, health issues, whatever. So there's always some level of anxiety and worry and fear in our day-to-day lives. But again, this, you know, video is more about the anxiety and the worry and the fear of the future and the uncertainty. And especially when it comes to jobs, because that's a big part, right, of our lives. And there's no one single answer to satisfy, to appease everyone. You can't just say, okay, everyone, let's just move back and become hunter-gatherers. You can't do that. You can't take all the people in Tokyo City or New York City and just say, leave the city and move out into the woods. There's nothing in the woods to hunt. I mean, there's deer, but I mean, just imagine, you know, taking all those people and tell them to go hunt and gather and, you know, return to monkey, as the meme goes. You know, there's just, it's not going to happen. So we're dependent on jobs. And, you know, for me personally, I grew up in the 70s or 80s. And this whole YouTube career of mine, I kind of, you know, I'm fortunate that I have, you know, the ability and the knowledge and the technical know-how to use computers and cameras and microphones and do the editing and do everything myself. Not to brag, but I'm just, you know, maybe that's in, you know, maybe I have ADHD and that's why I'm able to do all these different things and have all these different interests that kind of converge. And I turn into, you know, my ability to earn, generate an honest, you know, make an honest living. Which is, you know, all I really want to do personally. I'm not looking to make a ton of money. I just want to make enough money. Yeah, I don't need much. And we don't need much, but aside from my family and myself, there was worry. I did a video on my channel called All the Jobs I've Ever Had, and I've had, no lie, at least a dozen jobs, potentially around 16, 18 different jobs in different companies. And so there was, you know, worry about getting another job, you know, all throughout my life. And a lot of worry and anxiety leaving my career behind, all of my work experience, to do this full time. And, you know, I still have a little bit of worry about, you know, what might happen to YouTube, which is owned by Google. You know, how long am I going to be, are people going to continue to watch me? You know, maybe I'll be lucky enough to continue to do this for another 15 years until I can retire. I mean, I don't know. I've done this now. I run this channel now. I started in September of 2011. So this is going into the 12th year, but it wasn't until 2012 when I really started to make ASMR and more creative content. So it's more like 11 years. And I didn't leave my real, I mean, this is a real job, but I didn't leave my work and my career behind until, I think it was 2016. So if anything were to, you know, and I talk to my wife about this on occasion, you know, what happens if, you know, I can no longer do this, or I run out of ideas, or just, you know, for whatever reason, my whole YouTube thing just kind of plummets and dies, and I have to get a real job again. And sometimes the stress of this job of having to come up with ideas, new ideas. I don't like to do the same idea twice that much unless I can do it in a new and interesting way. But anyway, my whole point is there are times when the stress of this career, this job of mine gets to me, and I think about, you know what, I'm gonna walk away, and I'm gonna go back and into the work, into the field that I used to work in, and I'm employable. I can get a job doing anything. I mean, hell, if worse came to worst, I would, you know, get a job at McDonald's. But I wouldn't be happy working back in the field that I used to, because that's why I left my old career. I wasn't happy. So there are times when I'm, not that I'm not happy doing this, but there is stress involved. I mean, any job. So there are times when I'm a little unhappy or stressed with this and think about leaving. But if I were to get a different job or go back into my old career, I would be unhappy with there as well. So I really can't win. And it's not to say that I don't enjoy, that I'm not happy doing this content. No, this isn't about me, but I'm just trying to use myself as an example. You know, that's why I talk about myself. It's not to hear myself talk. It's to share my feelings, my experience, how I think, to reach anyone else out there going through the same thing. So I don't have anyone else here to talk with in these videos that I do. This is like a solo one-man operation. So I have to use my own thoughts and feelings and experiences to basically, you know, share them with anyone, you know, going through the same kind of thoughts and experiences. And to make a point, I need to use myself as an example. But believe me, just real quick, if I was completely stressed out and unhappy doing anything here on my channel, I would walk away for good. But most times when the stress gets to me a little bit, I'll just stop making a video for a few days and take a break. But I like to keep busy, and I like doing these videos you're listening to and watching now, as well as all the other ones. But anyway, enough about me. My whole point is that there is stress, and even I, you know, have worry and stress when it comes to, you know, even what I'm doing here on YouTube. This is my primary source of income. I'm going to be 52 this year. So, you know, how much longer can I keep doing this? How much longer will people continue to watch and tune in, you know? So those are valid, you know, how long is YouTube going to be around? Those are valid, you know, I'm sure YouTube will be around for a long time, I think. But you never know, right? So whether it's me or you or a plumber, electrician, an artist, you know, especially someone trying to sell your own art. Maybe you're a painter, sculptor. You're trying to run an Etsy business. You're trying to make, you want to do what you love for a living. And that can be difficult. I mean, when I started this channel, I never thought about it. It was always just a side thing, a side project. I had my main job. And just to kind of talk about, you know, starting your own thing. And then, you know, I was fortunate enough to turn this, you know, into my main source of income. So, you know, hopefully you can do that if you're trying to do that. So the worry and the anxiety and the stress of the unknown of the future, it doesn't it's always kind of there, kind of in the background a little bit, like a distant chatter on a radio, or the rustling of the leaves when you go for a walk, or the birds chirping in the distance. It's always that little voice, you know, that says, you know, what if I'm fired tomorrow? What if this company is bought next month? You know, what if, what if, what if? And, you know, so that's the future. And well, the quote future, there really is no future, like something that's already set in stone coming our way. But, you know, but that is tomorrow and next week. And the, you know, nothing in life is guaranteed. Today isn't a guarantee. Tomorrow isn't a guarantee. I would like to think, for the most part, there is a good chance that you and I, and, you know, anyone else listening, aren't going to be alive, and we'll have our jobs, and we'll have our income. You know, today, tomorrow, next week, a year from now, 5 years from now. I mean, I'm very fortunate and lucky, knock on wood, that to make it to be alive for 52 years, and every day I see an article about, you know, a 40-year-old person or a 50-year-old person that's passed away. And I think to myself, when's my day gonna come? Not to sound grim or depressing, but that's just like, I'm 52. And like, I swear, like, it's kind of like when you buy something and then you notice everyone else that has the same thing. Like, you buy a certain keyboard or sneaker, and now you notice everyone else that has the same thing. So it's that kind of thought process. You know, all these people in their 50s suddenly passing away. Like the actor who played Tony Soprano. James Gandolfini, I think. He passed away in his 50s. You know, a few years or so after the completion of the Sopranos TV show. He was out on vacation with family in Italy. And I think it was very hot. From what I understand, I just looked into this like a couple weeks ago. James Gandolfini and his family were in Italy on vacation, I think. It was very hot out. I think they were doing a lot of sightseeing or something like that. And then they end up going to his hotel room, I guess, at the end of the day. And I think he had a heart attack or a stroke, and he died. So you just, I mean, you never know. You could be not the healthiest person. You can be the healthiest person. And you just never know when death is going to, you know, call your number. You know, but fortunately, you know, most, I don't know what the percentage is, but it seems like a lot of people do get to live to an older age, but there's just always these freak kind of accidents or things, or who knows, but I don't want to dwell on that. But my whole point is, I mean, that's another thing, you know, I kind of worry about. When you're young, you don't really think like this. But it's not till you hit your 30s and your 40s and you start to get older. And that's when a lot of these thoughts seem to crop up. I don't remember, you know, being 15 or 20. I mean, I couldn't even formulate these kind of thoughts and have these kind of discussions at 20 years old or 15. I mean, it's taking me into my mid-40s and now in my 50s to be able to connect, make all the connections to talk like this. But I wasn't, You know, I took everything, I took my life for granted for the first, in the first 30 years. And then I met my wife, or my girlfriend at the time, early 2000s. We got married, and we had a son, family. And, you know, the next thing I know, my mortality is on my mind a lot more often than it ever used to be. But enough about that. But so, you know, the future uncertainty and how to cope with it. I mean, everyone has different coping mechanisms. I mean, most of us, we don't have these kind of discussions. You know, I like to talk. I like to, not to hear myself talk, but I like to talk about these things because it's just, we don't talk about these kinds of things on an everyday basis with our friends or people in our family. I mean, maybe you do have some friends where you get into some heady discussions like this, but I think most of us, for the most part, we go to school, we do our jobs, and then we zone out, we check out of reality, and we become escapists, and we watch our TV shows, or our movies, or we play our video games, or we do puzzles, or whatever hobby it might be that someone escapes the stress and anxiety of the real world, and they escape into that. I used to be, you know, just to talk about the future and the uncertainty, and how do you cope with that? I mean, everyone has, you know, different mechanisms and different ways of doing that. For me, it's not caring. And that's not to say that I don't care about people. I'm kind of like, my thoughts about people in the human race, that's like for another video. There are a lot of aspects and a lot of topics to talk about when it comes to the human race and the things that we do. Some of the good, a lot of the good things, a lot of the bad things. So, you know, that's a video I've been wanting to do for years, the pros and cons of the human race, or being human, or whatever you want to call it, you know. But anyway, so what was I talking about? Coping with the uncertainty and the future. And so, you know, every day, most of us, we don't try not to think about it. I mean, I'm sure the thought, you know, pops into our heads at some point throughout the day, you know. And I don't mean as far as, you know, and I'm talking about uncertainty in the future in regards to mostly jobs, right? But I guess it could expand. You know, mostly jobs, you know, is this, how long am I going to be able to do this job? You know, how long am I going to have this job at this company? How long is this company going to be around? You know, am I going to get laid off? You know, so there's that. But there's also, well, we can also talk about the uncertainty in the future about, you know, am I going to get a job? Or how about when it comes to other aspects like having a family? You know, am I ever going to have a family? Am I going to meet someone? Maybe you're single, looking for someone. So there's uncertainty, you know, in the future, and what's to happen tomorrow and then next week and the next few months and years. When it comes to different things, you know, relationships, jobs, of course, where you live, things you want to improve, your health, right? So, you know, this whole topic covers a wide gamut, a wide variety of different topics in regards to uncertainty and, you know, the future and the unknown and, you know, what's going to happen about this and that and the other thing. But, you know, getting back to AI, you know, and there's an artist or a writer, you know what's going to happen with that? Or are we going to be able to keep AI in check so it doesn't, you know, go out of control? And I don't mean AI getting out of control, like it becomes like some kind of movie scenario, like the Terminator. I mean, you know, I don't want to exaggerate and, you know, but who knows what might happen 100 years from now, 500 years from now. But right now, people are using AI for artistic purposes instead of maybe hiring an artist or for writing purposes, schoolwork. You know, who knows what other implications there might be. Manufacturing jobs, maybe clerical jobs where you have to type in things. Database, well, maybe you can get AI to, you know, do all the data entry. You know, feed a spreadsheet into an AI-driven application and, you know, you don't need a human being to do that. So who knows what the far-reaching implications are when it comes to AI. We, you know, I'm not, you know, it's what I want to say, the possibilities are limitless, I think. Because, you know, for the most part, you know, technology is able to do almost everything a human can do. You still need, except some things, like when it comes to farming, like there is still, you still need a human being to put the food stuff and the ingredients into the machine. And you need a human being to maintain the machine. So maintenance, you're going to need human beings for that. Now there are some jobs, like someone putting a new roof on a house, or having to dig, right? So you need human beings for that. But again, you know, will there ever be a robot, or robots, designed in such a way that they can replace human beings doing almost any job? Now, I would like to think almost anything is possible with technology. I mean, I don't think that's too far-fetched to think that at some point in the future, we will have made robots that can do almost anything a human being can do. And at that point, we'll have AI operating those robots. And so what will humans be needed for? And then humans die out, and then eventually you have a completely driven Terminator-type scenario where robots and AI work in tandem, doing everything or doing nothing. And human beings have become like a, you know, living in poverty. And, you know, I mean, it seems like a stretch. It seems maybe fictional, nonsensical, but I don't really think so. When you take a look at how advanced we are now and the things that car manufacturing companies can do with the machines there and the machines, you know, at certain food manufacturing companies, you know, that bake the, I don't know, think of any snack, how the snack is made by a machine and conveyor belts, and heated and covered in chocolate and then put into a bag. And then the only human interaction is probably cleaning the machines, maintaining them, putting the cocoa and the ingredients, you know, supplying, delivering the ingredients. But machines do all the work, and then you have the worker, you know, doing some QA, quality assurance, on the packages, you know, making sure, looking at the chocolates as they go down the conveyor belt, maybe. But who's, you know, a robot could do that. You design a robot, you know, some kind of, you know, machine. And then, you know, what will humans be needed for? So you can have machines performing the maintenance on machines. So, you know, so it's a little scary. But so how do we cope with all of this, right? And there's so many different scenarios. It's not just artists and writers and clerical workers being affected, impacted by AI. People have been out of jobs because of technology for centuries. I mean, this goes back to when farming and agriculture came around, you know? Advances in technology have been putting people out of work and jobs forever. You know? And so that's nothing new, really, when it comes to AI. It might just affect a certain type of career or job right now, artists and writers, and maybe clerical workers, but 5, 10, 50, 100 years from now, who's to say that AI, you know, who's to say there's no longer any teachers needed when you can just turn your computer on and there's an AI doing all the classwork, giving out the homework. Maybe you use an AI to do the homework. I mean, at what point are you even, like, what's the point of even living or being a human being when everything is AI run, AI driven, maintained by AI and robots, maybe? You know, then we have sports. I don't know. There's so many different areas. Sports and plumbing, musicians, entertainers. I mean, you know, what jobs will be eradicated by AI and robots, and what jobs will still be around, and what are the implications? I'm sure there's a lot of books out there and articles and people with more knowledge than me that have spoken on this subject, but I'm just kind of bringing my own unique perspective to this. So, but again, beyond AI and jobs, and no matter how old or young you are, and what career you have, the future and the uncertainty, no matter what it is, job, family, health, it is a source of worry and anxiety and all that. And so how do we cope? And for me, not caring is kind of how I cope. Not that I don't care about people. I kind of started to talk about this, and then I went off about doing another video about human beings. But you kind of just have to not really care about what's going to happen. You kind of have to live for now and today and not think so much about the future or about implications or about what's going to happen. You just have to take each day as it is and do what you can and then escape and enjoy some leisure time how you like, and then just hope that everything's going to work out and everything's going to be just fine. Because even if the future and a job was a guarantee. There are so many different other variables at play in life when it comes to your own life and how you're going to live that's not necessarily a guarantee. I mean, you don't know what kind of illness you might get, an accident you might be in. Forget about just the job. So the tendrils of life spread out in so many different ways. Jobs, job security, health, relationships, and money, and rent, and financial. And there's so many different topics and things that when it comes to the future and uncertainty, it's not just about a job, right? So it covers a wide gamut of different aspects of life. And so how do you cope? And so for me, I was raised Roman Catholic. I was taught the concepts of God, heaven and hell, eternal life, if I was a good Catholic, or eternal damnation, if I sinned. I don't believe in any of that. I have come to terms with the fact, which I believe is most likely the fact, that when we die, that's it. So all the stress and all the achievements will be, and all the good times and all the memories, not to, I hate to get onto a sour note here and sound depressing, but eventually your mind starts to go. You forget everything that you once accomplished and enjoyed, and your memories decay, and then you die, and then that's it, and what was it all for? Right? So you get this one shot. Really, I'm pretty sure. Even if you get reincarnated, you're not going to remember your past life. All right? So I'm sure there's no heaven or hell. There's no nirvana. There's no reincarnation. There's just this organism that we call human being. It lives. It navigates the landscape of modern society. For me personally, I've avoided any major accidents, life-threatening. You never know what today or tomorrow will bring. And then I have so many good memories, bad memories, worries, anxiety, right? And then what happens? You get older and everything starts to decay in entropy. And then you die and that's it. And, you don't even realize you're dead. You're in eternal sleep, an eternal slumber. And then another human being is born, and maybe you experience life as that human being, but you would never know. And I'm not talking about reincarnation, just a sidetrack. Why am I experiencing, like, this human being you're looking at and you're listening to? I've always thought about this, different points in my life. Why am I experiencing and doing all this as this human being? It's kind of strange when you think about it. I'm experiencing this life. I'm getting into like a stoner philosophical type of thing right now. But I've always thought about that. Right? Obviously, I'm this human being, so I am going to experience life as this human being. But is it possible to experience life again as another human being? Not as reincarnation. Once I die, this human being and everything I'm going to know, and my senses and everything I see and hear and feel is going to be no more. It's going to come to an end. But will I get to experience life again as another human being? Not transferring my soul, just when I die. And then when another human being is born, will I experience life again as that human being? But I won't know that I'm experiencing life again. I'll just think I'm that new child, that new baby, and I'll come up with my own, you know, thoughts and beliefs and all that. So it's kind of strange when you think about it, you know, how we experience life, and then, well, then, you know, what makes us different? I don't know. I'm kind of, when that's something I think from time to time. And one last thing I want to say about coping is try not to take the anxiety and stress and worry about the future, the uncertainty, whether you're moving, changing jobs, going to have a family, leaving a relationship, getting into a relationship, who knows what it might be. There's a myriad of different things that can, different situations that can cause us to, you know, worry and have stress and anxiety over them. Try not to hurt yourself or poison yourself. Now, I really hate to preach. Everyone is entitled to do whatever they want with their lives. Right? I'm not going to try to tell you what to do, but I would like to say that, you know, if you're drinking alcohol, smoking cigarettes, or anything worse to cope, I would just like to ask that maybe you think about those things and thinking about not doing them or cutting back and making a healthier change so you live a healthier life. And that's all I ask. You're free to drink and smoke or vape or do whatever drugs. That's your life and those are your choices. But I've given up alcohol and cigarettes, and I've never done hard drugs. I still eat kind of fatty foods and sugar. You know, those are my vices. It's hard for me to go a day without having something sweet. Yeah, it doesn't mean I eat cookies and cake and ice cream every day, but I usually have something. Maybe peanut butter crackers, or fruit. But a few times a week, you know, I still eat sugary stuff. You know, I don't do soda. We don't have soda or iced tea in the house. So we keep the artificial sweetened stuff to a minimum. But so those are my vices. So I enjoy my sweets. You know, I don't smoke or drink anymore, do hard drugs or anything. So that's how I cope whenever I'm stressed. And there's also escaping into entertainment, video games. And like I said, even if I wasn't here on this planet doing these videos, people are still going to do what they want. And you are free to do what you want. But I would just like to say, to ask, just to think about some of the choices so you don't hurt yourself. So you can live when you get older. You have less health or less potential to have health complications. I'm most likely going to get diabetes at some point. In my 50s or 60s. You know, usually, you know, it's hard to live in modern society and not have diabetes at some point. Usually adult onset diabetes. You know, it's a guarantee. Unless you have amazing genetics. And aside from the diabetes, you know, who knows what other, you know, as I get older. But so I've try to cut back on the things that don't make me feel good, for one, that I know aren't good for me, for two, you know, the sugar and the steak and the McDonald's once a month. You know, diabetes and probably high cholesterol probably going to kill me if old age doesn't, or an accident, or aliens, you know, who knows, or a nuclear war. So you just have to, all right, so I wanted to say that about your health. And to finish the video here, you know, how you cope, you know, and have less anxiety. And what I do is try not to care. I try not to care about what's going to happen. I try to live just a very now. Right now, it's all that matters. I'm not going to worry about what's going to happen tomorrow too much. I mean, sure, I have these thoughts, but a lot of things are out of my control, and that's part of it. You can't worry about the things you can't control. You know, no matter what it is, you just can't change the world. You're not meant to change the world. Did I want to say that? I guess what I mean is, if you don't like all the different things that are happening in the world, no, what I really mean to say is, the world isn't supposed to be in any design, particular design, or operated in a certain way, the world or modern society, based on any one of us or a group of us. It's just supposed to be however it's supposed to be from day to day. Government, no government, these kind of laws, no kind of laws, this kind of artificial intelligence or restricting artificial, I mean, who knows? There's no one set handbook or rule book that says this is how life is supposed to be. It's just 8 billion human beings with the freedom to do as they please. And there isn't anyone to say otherwise. We can have laws in place for when you do certain things, then there are consequences. But even laws aren't necessary, not aren't necessarily meant to be followed. I'm not saying break any laws, but these laws are man-made. The only thing we need to follow, or we have to follow, is the law of gravity, right? Sleeping, because you need to sleep, eating and drinking, right? You need to do those. But when it comes to everything else, no, you're free to do whatever you please, whether you want to be an alcoholic or do hard drugs or not. I mean, so, you know, it's a complex thing, but just to finish here, so the future, the uncertainty, very anxiety driven, whether it's AI taking over your job, whether it's the uncertainty of having a family, whether it's the uncertainty of your health, whether you're leaving high school this year, graduating, and the wide open door of uncertainty with the rest of your future and what are you going to do with your life now, whether you're in a career now, and you know, the uncertainty of how long you'll be at that job, or and all that, the uncertainty of being in a certain apartment or buying a home. I mean, there are so many, as I said, it's a wide gamut, a wide range of things and problems and situations that one can worry about and that are anxiety driven when it comes to uncertainty in the future and all that. So everyone copes differently, and for me, I just try not to worry about anything until the thing happens. Try to take care of it the best that I can. And, you know, try not to worry about the things that are going to happen that are not a guarantee, and just live for now, live for the moment, you know, save some money if you can, you know, kind of live for the future that way. But at the same time, try not to just right now is all that matters, you know? That kind of thing. And, you know, and taking care of yourself if you can, exercising, eating healthy, you know, making the best choices you can when it comes to a healthier lifestyle. So those are things that will cut back on the worry. Right? So you eat healthy and you go see the doctor once a year for your annual checkup. And it says your cholesterol and your sugar levels are okay or maybe getting a little higher like me. So you make some health adjustments, and that's one less thing to worry about, right? So there are some things you can do to counterattack or counterbalance any worries or anxieties about life. And there are some things we can do, like when it comes to AI and robots potentially replacing the human race, every single job in existence. I mean, who knows, right? I mean, robot managers, a robot president. I mean, it is possible with the technology that it gets to that point where robots and AI converge and they, I mean, who knows? You know, what is intelligence? And that's a whole other discussion to have as well. All right, so I think I've talked enough and I touched on everything I wanted to. Again, I just kind of wanted to come here and talk about AI. But not just that, but this whole worldview, a bigger view, the big picture when it comes to, you know, why are we worried about AI? Well, because it's going to take over some people's jobs. But that's no different than any other job throughout human history, any other job or, you know, not just job, but any other field. I'm not sure what other word I'm looking for. Yeah, but it's nothing new, really. And, you know, so I just wanted to touch on, you know, the big picture, and the big picture is that life is, there's no guarantees, it's uncertain. The future is often unknown and uncertain. And all you can do is your best with your health, try to make the best decisions that you can financially, try to save some money, you know, and all that. And hopefully that will, it won't help with whatever is to come. It's not going to change the world. Whatever's going to happen beyond our control is going to happen. But there are some things that we can try to do to minimize the worry and the anxiety. But just when you think everything's okay, then something major happens. You know, there's a fire in your house, strange freak accident, tornado. I mean, there's just so many different random things and events and situations, accidents, whatever, crime that you can find yourself a part of that can disrupt and be life-altering, you know, for you know, PTSD or physical disability and financial ruin. And just when you think everything is going fine. So, but what can you do? You don't know those events are going to happen, right? So you just live every day. You know, you gotta put on a smile and you gotta just be tough and toughen up and not think about it and not care. Because, you know, what are you going to do? You can't just live in a cave and just eat dirt and worms. I mean, you're free to do that if you want, and, you know, good luck, but no, so live, enjoy life, and I'll just finish with this, expect the worst, but hope for the best, you know, be a cynical optimist. Bad things are probably going to happen, you know, the future might be bleak, but try to be optimistic that maybe it won't be as bleak. Or, you know, maybe you just got to try to be optimistic. And because it's no fun being depressed and all that. So it's not always easy. I'm 52 and I still have my dark, down kind of moods and my days. You know, and then I get through them. I don't know if I'm bipolar because sometimes I feel like really down. Not so much as I used to, but I just feel blah, especially when it's rainy and cloudy out. And then I have my moods where I have a lot of energy and like everything's great and nothing's going to stop me. Of course, those are seem to be the sunny days. But, you know, that's me. But anyway, so, you know, just make the best of it. And I wish you all the best, you know, whoever you are, whatever life has in store for you. And I wish you nothing but the best of luck, that you get to live a long, healthy life. Or if you do happen to incur any kind of tragedy or anything, that you still find ways to be happy and to live and find some joy in life and all that, all right? So I think that's going to do it. Once again, thanks for joining me. It's great to have you. And hopefully get a chance to speak to you, you know, next week, next Tuesday, and see you in any other videos I do until then. And until then, here's to the future being good, good luck in the coming hours and days ahead of us. And, you know, knock on wood, nothing tragic, you know, happens to any of us, but every day there is someone experiencing something tragic. That's life. I mean, you look at the rest of the animal kingdom. Every day there's an animal, there's a rabbit, there's a young, you know, birds, bird eggs, snake eating bird eggs, young birds that haven't had a chance to hatch, frogs getting eaten by snakes, alligators attacking young antelope, lions. I mean, it's, life isn't meant to be smooth sailing. We have it pretty easy as human beings. We have, you know, we don't have any predators. The only thing we have is, you know, each other, you know, violence and disease and, you know, disabilities and cancer and things like that, various illnesses, you know, but that's life. Life isn't meant to be perfect, but so all we can do is try to make the best of it and try to, you know, go at it with a positive attitude, even though it's not always easy. So it's not meant to be always a struggle or always smooth sailing. It's supposed to be a healthy balance of peace and war, peace and conflict. The conflicting, stressful moments, and then some moments when you get a chance to be at peace. And that's the balance of life, in my view. You know, everything's fine when you're hungry and your bills are paid, or at least when you're hungry. But then you get, everything's fine when you've been satisfied, especially in regards to your hunger and your thirst. Your thirst has been quenched. But then a few hours later, you're hungry again. And so you gotta eat. And in order to eat, something has to die. Plant. Some type of organism. Because we sure ain't gonna live just eating inanimate objects like rocks or dirt. So, alright. A nice little happy thought to end this episode with. Alright, so I wish you nothing but the best. when it comes to the future that lies ahead for you. And hopefully I get a chance to speak to you next week, next episode. And until then, hopefully I'll see you in some other videos. So until then, so long and take care for now.